हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग। वेलकम अगेन टू द क्लास ऑफ इंग्लिश लिटरेचर। इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो वी रेड ओड ऑन ए ग्रेसियन अर्न बाय जॉन किट्स। इन दैट वीडियो वी कवर्ड इट्स टू स्टेंजास। नाउ वी विल स्टार्ट विद नेक्स्ट थर्ड स्टेंजा। आई एम रीडिंग आउट दिस स्टेंजा। आ हैप्पी हैप्पी बाउज दैट कैन नॉट सैड योर लीव्स नॉर एवर बिड द स्प्रिंग एड्यू एंड हैप्पी मेलोडिस्ट अनवियरिड फॉर एवर पाइपिंग सॉन्ग्स फॉर एवर न्यू मोर हैप्पी लव मोर हैप्पी हैप्पी लव फॉर एवर वार्म एंड स्टिल टू बी इंजॉयड फॉर एवर पेंटिंग एंड फॉर एवर यंग आल ब्रीदिंग ह्यूमन पैशंस फार अबव दैट लीव्स ए हार्ट हाई सोरोफुल एंड क्लॉइड a burning forehead and a parching tongue. Now we will explain this stanza line by line. In line number 21 and 21 means in line number first and second of this stanza, the poet is saying that the branches of the trees never lose their leaves because the world of the earth never changes, because it is a picture and picture never changes. The speaker is saying that it is always springtime, the trees are always green. To bid adieu is to say goodbye. Here the word is used, adieu is has meaning to say goodbye. Here the speaker says that the branches of the tree are fortunate because they never have to say goodbye to the spring. They will always enjoy the season of spring. In the next two lines, the speaker says that the melodist, means the piper, is also happy like anyone else in this world. He is also unwearied, which means he never gets tired. In line number 24, the speaker says that the songs played by the musician are always fresh and new. Again, that is because the world of the urn never changes. It has frozen in time. Now, in the next line, the poet has used the word happy for three times. It means that he is encouraging the musician to keep playing by calling for more songs. Now, in the next two lines, the speaker seems to have returned to the first image on the urn, that of the man or gods chasing a bunch of women, and he imagines that everyone in the scene is at the peak of their erotic excitement. The men are just about to catch the woman, but they have not yet do so. So they always have the big moment ahead of them. Means they will always follow that group of women, and this chasing will give them enjoyment. इन लाइन नंबर 26 दिस लाइन रेफर्स टू द बॉडीज ऑफ द वुमन विच आर वार्म एंड स्टिल टू बी इंजॉयड. एंड इन लाइन नंबर 27 दिस लाइन रेफर्स टू बोथ मैन एंड वुमेन हु आर पेंटिंग फ्रॉम देयर चेस. दे आर रनिंग एंड द रनिंग इज बिकमिंग द कॉज ऑफ देयर पेंटिंग. पेंट PANT पेंट मीन्स होता है हाँफना. उनके दौड़ने के कारण वो हाँफ रहे हैं. द स्पीकर keeps using the word forever to make the point that the people on the urn are frozen in time. The world of art is eternal. In line number 28, 29 and 30. These lines suggest that the lovers that are pictured on that urn are better than or far above the breathing human passion of the normal world. And when our speaker looks at the happy lovers, the speaker's heart becomes high, sorrowful and cloyed. To be cloyed is to have too much of a good thing. In Hindi, we can say ubna. The speaker is overpowered by his excitement, and instead of a warm and pleasant panting, he feels feverish with a burning forehead and desperately thirsty with a parching of tongue. Now we will move towards to our stanza number 4th. Who are these coming to the sacrifice? To what green altar or mysterious priest leadest thou that heifer lowing at the skies and all her silken flanks with garlands dressed? What little town by river or seashore or mountain built with peaceful citadel is emptied of this folk this pious morn? And little town, thy streets forever, for evermore will silent be, and not a soul to tell why thou art desolate can ever return. Now we are in stanza number 4. The speaker is looking at the third scene or the third picture on the urn, which depicts an animal sacrifice. In the starting two lines, our speaker talks to the priest on the urn, asking him, "Hey, where are you headed?" He wants to know to what green altar he is taking a cow, a heifer. In classical times, an altar was a place where sacrifices were carried out, and this one is covered with the leaves and vegetation that make it green. The poor cow must know that what is coming because it mourns or lows at the sky. Its sides, which we call flanks, are dressed in a string or garland of flowers. This cow is a holy object destined for the gods. In the next three lines, here with the help of these lines, we can now piece together the whole third scene. There is a priest, a cow, a green altar, and a crowd of people following behind in anticipation of the sacrifice. The speaker infers that this crowd must have come from somewhere, from some little town, but the town isn't depicted, so he has to imagine what it must look like. This scene doesn't have anything besides people and cows in it, but he comes up with a few guesses as to what the town looks like. It is either by a river or by a seashore or on a mountain. If it is on a mountain, he imagines a small fortress called Citadel must protect it. But that is not a great need to be defended, so the citadel is peaceful. This truly a perfect world. Everyone is outside, enjoying the weather and looking forward to the ritual. The town is emptied. The town is emptied because it is a pious or holy morning. Now, in the last three lines, the speaker talks to the town to inform it that its street will always be silent and desolate of people. Although the speaker knows that everyone is headed to a sacrifice, but he doesn't know what the sacrifice is for, and he can never find out because there is not a soul to tell the reason for the holiday. Since they are frozen on the urn, so they won't be able to come again. Thus the village will be always empty. Now we will move towards to our last stanza, stanza number 5th. Oh, a tick sap, fair attitude, with braid of marble men and maidens, overwrought with forest branches and the trodden weed, thou silent form dost tease us out of thought, as doth eternity called pastoral. When old age shall this generation waste, thou shalt remain in midst of other woe, then ours a friend to man to whom thou sayest beauty is truth, truth beauty, that is all you know on earth and all you need to know. Now in this stanza, the speaker has raptures over its attic shape, which just means it has a distinctively Greek appearance, and its fair attitude, which means a graceful posture. The lovers are braided together in the chiseled marble, which is wild image. It makes the carving sound complicated and ornate. Indeed, the speaker calls the depiction overwrought or too complicated. We already know that the urn has decorative images of plants all over it, and now the speaker is annoyed with the forest branches and the trodden weed that seem to be choking the poem with vegetation. Now in line number 44 and 45th, here the speaker addresses the urn and says that the urn is so mysterious and baffling that it's impossible to think about. The poet compares the experience of looking at the urn to thinking about eternity. Finally, he calls the scenes depicted on the urn a cold pastoral. Pastoral imagery concerns nature and simple country life, rural life. Now in line number 46, 47 and 48. Here in these lines, the speaker imagines that after everyone in his generation is dead, the urn will still be around. The problems or woe of the present generation will have been replaced by new problems, but the urn, like a good therapist and friend of man, won't be lacking in advice to give new generations. In fact, it has always given the same advice to everyone throughout history, which is, beauty is truth and truth beauty, means both are the same things. Beauty and truth are both are the same things. And this is all you know, and this is the thing you need to know. Means you don't need any truth of religious or philosophical text or history books. And you don't need truths that are passed down through tradition. This was the whole explanation of this poem. I hope you got the theme of the poem. We shall meet with a new video. Till then, goodbye. Thank you.